So on this new Empath record that I put out, there's a lot of these kind of, I don't know, new agey or spiritual images. And in fact, I've kind of had that throughout my career, be it transcendence or infinity or whatever. And on Empath, it's really pronounced, where there's, you know, guys in meditation poses and lotus and all this sort of thing. And admittedly, throughout my life, I've always been interested in that stuff. For whatever reason, it's just always been a draw for me. And had this been 10 years ago, I think that the reasons why it was included on this stuff could have been much different than it is now. But I'm 46 years old now, and over the past couple of years, I've really gotten into trying to meditate. And the reason I'm bringing this up is because even my reasons for doing it now are different than it once was. When I was younger, I used to think it was about trying to attain some sort of enlightenment or try and you know, be holier than thou or whatever it was. But I realize now more than ever that I'm just, I'm a mess, you know, more now than ever. But a lot of the reasons why I think I'm a mess, and maybe a lot of the reasons why I'm not more of a mess than I am, is because I overthink. I think about things way too much. I analyze things way too much. And whatever that is, I mean, I've spent years trying to think about that. I think about thinking. It's like, maybe it's narcissism, maybe it's this and that, the other thing. So I started really trying to meditate because in a similar way to exercising, where you're, as you get older, your muscles aren't as strong as they once were, and your bones aren't as dense. And so you exercise to not be ripped, but just to try and not be like a total disaster. Meditation for me now acts as a way to work out my mind, and it helps me not think as much. So in the morning and at night, I do a meditation that isn't rooted in what it once was, which was, oh, I've got to become enlightened. In fact, every time I tried to do that when I was a kid, it's like I realized that it's like I just think about my day, I think about food, I think about all these things. But it wasn't until about a year and a half ago where I started really investigating it that I came across a YouTube thing that gave me a real good insight to it. And they said, if what you're trying to do with meditation is just not be as inside your own head as you are, so you can be more functional for the people that you care about, don't think of it as a goal. Don't think of it as, you know, I'm not meditating, I'm not doing it right. Think of it more as, realize when your mind strays, and then basically get over it, and then go back to your breath, and then fail and start again, fail, start again, fail, start again, fail, start again, and then get up. And just a simple act of doing that, not of thinking, okay, well, I'm doing it or I'm not doing it. It's just, it's almost like the process of recognizing when your mind is spinning, and then pulling it back without being super hard on yourself, is almost like doing bicep curls for that inability to just focus. And my tendency to spin off in all sorts of directions mentally is such that practice has really allowed me to sort of rein in some of that anxiety. And so that's what I use it for, honestly. I don't think of it in terms of any sort of the religious or spiritual jargon. I mean, I think all that stuff is just such, not bullshit, but I think it can tend to get that way. So you'll see in the Empath record, there is a lot of that. And recently, unrelated to this, I had the opportunity to go to India. And again, had this been 10 or 20 years ago, I think I would have thought of that as an opportunity to go find myself, you know, like go take a bath in the Ganges while some dude's taking a dump beside me or whatever it was, and or go to some ashram and wear some brightly colored thing and pretend that I wasn't full of shit, and then come back and tell everybody that I was, you know, what they should do to not be full of shit. But it wasn't that. It was, I had some friends that were getting married, and they said, would you like to come to India? And I said, yeah, I'd love to go to India. I've always wanted to go to India. But this time I went without any sort of sense of like the religious thing at all. And so I went and I spent 3 weeks there, basically, maybe a little less than 3 weeks, but in and around that time. And it was, you know, you can't quantify it unless you've been there. It's hard to quantify it just because it's bananas. Like it's a culture that is very removed from a lot of things that I had experienced before. And I've been to a lot of places and I've seen a lot of things, but I'd never seen anything with that level of like emotional intensity. And how I think it plays into these interests that I've had with meditation or anything like that is in ways I didn't expect. So I didn't go to any churches. I didn't go to any religious sites. I mean, I went and saw some of the tourist things, but I was there with a group of friends and you know, we traveled around and saw Taj Mahal and things like this. But the way that I found it really affected me was, I think, in the sort of first world that I live, I'm very fortunate to have been raised in Canada, and you know, if you're from the States or the Netherlands or Germany or Japan, a lot of places you see these sort of images of the disparity between have and have not. I mean, we see it all the time, and we hear about poverty and extreme poverty and pollution and things like this, but it's like an abstraction to us in a lot of ways. And by going there, the thing that really I think I'll take from that experience is not the you know, the backpacking and things that I wanted to do, but more it really made real a type of reality that we're just not privy to. And I came out of it with a sense of optimism, strangely, because a lot of times, you know, you'll stop at the light, and there'll be like just a dozen six-year-old kids without parents that are knocking on the window and looking for money, and you know, then you find out that they're like also they're controlled by these cartels, and like the money doesn't go to these children. And it's like, as somebody who's got like a sense of any sort of sense of empathy, it's like brutal to like have to ignore this and see this, and like the animals and the billions of people and all this. But it was really healthy in a way, because, you know, the friends that I have there, like the sense of humor is really similar, and it's like there's a lot of musicians there, and I, you know, I got a lot of friends there now that I relate to in a similar way to people that I know in the States or Germany or any of these places. It's like people are people wherever you go. But because of just a population of that size and with that sort of lineage of this and that and the other thing, it was really sobering to witness that level of like poverty. And I think it gives me a chance to sort of reflect on my own life, my own work, and, you know, how privileged we are to even have the opportunity to have an existential crisis. I mean, like, you run into a whole faction of humanity that don't have anything. And then you come home and you think, oh, you know, all my life and my music, and I don't know, maybe the song's gonna work, and maybe the song, and maybe I should meditate for a while, maybe I should get like a little brass Buddha and put him in my room. And, you know, it's like, it's all just such privilege in a sense. And I think that although it's gonna take me a long time to quantify the experience and to sort of wrap my head around what it is, I think at this point, at least, I'm able to say what it's made me feel is you gotta be thankful for what you have. And I think that although there's like a certain amount of like feelings of guilt where like, oh, these people have so much or so little and I don't have these problems, and therefore I feel like I have like a certain amount of guilt with that, it's like, I think you can do what you can do, and you can really take these things to heart, and you can really try and incorporate it into some sort of sense of what your social responsibilities are, and recycling and all this. But I mean, it's so much bigger than us. It's got, you can only, it blew my mind, and I'm still blown away by it. I don't know. It was so much, but luckily I think I've come out of it with a sense of not all is lost, but that, you know, there's still a lot of beauty there. It was intense. But I think if there's anything that I can say immediately, that all the sort of quasi-religious and new agey and meditational things that I've been into for so long, it just took on a whole other light. It wasn't, it was more of like a hobby. I think a lot of this is like a hobby, and the truth of it is a lot more real. It's a lot more intense, and it's a lot harder to emotionally accept. But I'm working on it. And I think that a lot of us in this sort of first world thing should at least have the experience of seeing that level of like poverty. It's you can't really understand it, you know? Anyway, I think as an artist, it will do me good. And as a human being, it's certainly done me good. And I think it's good sometimes to feel ridiculous, you know?